My pleasure to be here with three really remarkable creative artists, two musicians and a photographer. To my far right is Nabeel Abboud-Ashkar. To Nabeel's left is Merlijn Twaalfhoven. Merlijn is coming to us from Holland, so he's not just a Flatlander. He comes from below sea level. And then to my immediate right is Frédéric Brenner. Frédéric is a photographer, and we'll learn more about all of their work as we get deeper into this. As always with these panels, I struggle a little bit when I first get the list of people and I learn a little bit about their work, because on one level, it seems that they do something very similar, but as you dig into it, then it seems that it's really very different, and I struggle to find the connections between what they're doing, what a man who's a violinist and runs a music school does, what a composer who works with large numbers of people to do kind of public ritual forms of musical expression, and what a photographer who has spent his life really parsing the social life and differences of Israel. What could possibly be in common here? And the only thing that I found, but it seemed more and more meaningful as I thought about it, is that they all deal with, in some senses, an effort to create a space apart from the worlds in which they're working. Whether that's a safe space to do something collectively, whether that's a space that simply shuts out ideology and religion and noise and conflict. One might not know what actually happens there, but for a time, those things don't happen, and there's some benefit from that. And also a sense of space that's very internal. A sense of art as a way of exploring our own sense of identity, our own dividedness, our own multiplicity of identities. So I think space will be a theme today. But why don't we get down to details about what they're actually doing. So Nabeel, tell us a little bit more about your exposure to classical music and how that grew into an organization called Polyphony.
Well, I was born in Nazareth. It's an Arab-Palestinian town in the north of Israel. You can't hear me now? But that's shouting. Can we bring this up, please?
Yeah.
You want to try one more time? ABC.
Is this okay now?
Yeah.
Great. They are picky.
Well, so adjust this as we can, but give it another try.
Okay, I'm going to just start talking and then it will adjust. So I was born in Nazareth, which is an Arab-Palestinian town in the northern part of Israel. I guess most of you know another person who came from there. quite famous. I was fortunate to be born to a family that was very unusual and cared a lot about classical music. So we grew up listening to Bach and Mozart and Tchaikovsky at home. And my parents had the courage and maybe a little bit madness to encourage us to pursue classical music as a profession and as a way of life. And in 2006, when I was doing my master's degree in Germany, I moved back to Nazareth to found the first school of classical music in Nazareth and in the Arab community in Israel, with the intention to bring for the first time a proper classical music training into the Arab community. That was my purpose, at least. I had no any bigger agendas or dreams at that point. And we had very little support, and I believe strongly that the talent is there, that there's no reason why Arab kids are not talented and wouldn't be able to play classical music on a high standard. And I had the challenge of finding the right teachers. And that, for me, meant to go to Tel Aviv and convince some of my Jewish colleagues to drive 2 hours to come to Nazareth and teach young Arab kids. And to my great satisfaction, they agreed. So we started with 3 Jewish teachers, myself, and 25 students. This is how Polyphony started. Polyphony is today reaching out to over 12,000 kids. Thank you. And it was very impressive to see the level of commitment, of talent, the interaction between the teachers, the parents, and the students, the fact that the little kids didn't speak Hebrew and the parents had to be present in the class was actually an added value because the parents had to be involved. And it developed the relationship between those 3 corners. By the 2nd or 3rd year, little kids from Nazareth, both Muslim and Christian Arabs, were participating in major competitions in Israel and winning those competitions.
So it's gone from being an introduction of classical music to Arab students, to including Arab and Jewish students. And what's the highest level which the students are now playing? Is it approaching a professional level?
Well, I can give you an example. Well, now they don't hear you. So.
Repeat my question.
Well, asking about what is the level that our students have reached at this point. And I can give you a nice example. About 2 years ago, we decided for two of our violin students to participate in the Paul Ben-Haim competition, which is one of the most prestigious competitions in the country. And the theme is Israeli music, classical music composed in Israel. It's modern, it's very technical, very challenging. And again, by chance, it was Muslim and Christian young violinists at that time, the age of 15 and 16. And so they got, you know, they prepared and they went to Tel Aviv and they passed the first round. I didn't even bother to go there because I thought they're going to be probably kick them after the first round. And then they pick up the phone, they tell me that they passed. And then the next day they passed the second round. And in the third round I had to go to Tel Aviv to see what's happening. And they played so well that they both received the first prize. And no second prize was given. So within 6 years, we were able to get from no classical music in the Arab community to the point where the finest young musicians in the country are coming from Nazareth. Another competition in Israel is called the Keren Sharet, which hundreds of Israel's finest musicians apply every year. And at this point, we have more than 12 students every year winning these awards. So we were able to achieve that, to bring classical music on the highest level, for the local community to embrace it, and this is the most important part. The community didn't feel that this is something that was enforced from the outside, but it's something that's growing from the inside, and year after year, more parents and family embrace the idea.
Great.
And briefly, I will say that about 3 years ago, after we have accomplished our first goal, we started to think how we can use music and classical music to bridge the divide between Arab and Jewish communities in Israel. And this is how Polyphony, as an idea, an organization, came to life.
Great, thank you. Merlijn, I was thinking of the phrase that Nabeel just used, that it sort of grew inherently there, grew within. That, in a way, sort of describes every individual project you've done, in some senses. And I wonder if you could tell us about a musical piece, I'm not even sure that's the right word, but a musical event called Carried on the Wind?
Oh, Carried by the Wind.
Carried by the Wind.
Yeah, it was actually a concert took place on rooftops in Bethlehem, the Palestinian city just next to Jerusalem. There was a long journey before I decided to place musicians on rooftops to actually play over the big wall that's segregating them actually from each other. First of all, I was a composer really focusing on notes, on music, on melodies, harmonies. But then I experienced, if you give a concert, actually what people experience is much more the concert setting, being seated, watching musicians on stage delivering something beautiful, you know? And I wanted to design more than only a small percentage of that experience. And I started taking people out of their concert halls. So I started really designing experiences where sound and space kind of interact, and you feel also your position in the space, well, defined by the whole event. And my role as a composer, became much more complex because I had to design, the whole event, not just the music. And also I became aware that the music, it's important, but the way people relate to each other, that like the social event that is the essence, I think, of a concert, that is actually the even more important. So that was an identity crisis as a composer. But when I started to create music for spaces, I became also attracted to the Middle East, the whole situation where people dispute lands, where generations are in conflict about who owns land. It's all a question about relating from a person to their space. And first, I wanted to create an Israeli orchestra at one side of the wall and a Palestinian at the other side, and to make music, and that, you know, you can cross, the sound can cross easily, you know? No one can shoot down the sound. So, but then I really, really changed my concept, because that's implying like the humans being equal and meeting on in an equal way. But the reality of that whole wall crossing the community, you know, it was not dividing the Israeli land from the Palestinian land. No, it was really going through the village, really disturbing the whole community there, made me create a whole different event. And involving all kind of local musicians, we kind of made space for them to climb upon their own roofs, to make music, reaching out to the land where their own olive trees were there, but that they couldn't reach. So it became a whole different experience.
And just is the wrong medium. I'm going to ask you in words, and you're a composer, but what did it sound like? I mean,
well, because the distance of the different groups of musicians on different rooftops, you know, I gave them all clocks that were all synchronized. There was no conductor to say that this is the start. We just said, we start at 5 o'clock sharp. And then 2 minutes after five, you start with some kind of percussion there, and there comes an answer from the other side. So not always did it work. Some of the clocks were broken. So it became much more like a kind of a natural event where, you know, if the weather changes, some clouds come. And that was also with the sounds. For me, it felt all out of control, you know. The musicians were on the rooftops. I couldn't just call them and say, like, you have to play certain notes, you know. They were on their own. But they started also kind of improvising, playing with the distance. So my role, again, as a composer, was pretty limited. It was more like creating an environment that people did something totally out of the ordinary. And especially, we had no slogans, we had no texts. So when people came to the place where we performed, they asked, like, why are you doing that? We had no answer. So there was actually not somebody to answer, because it was just some musicians on the rooftops. So it became just like being there and relating to the space in the present, not relating to a future that you want or a past that you're very pissed off about. No, it's about being here and doing something with your time and sharing that event.
It's remarkable. You can find a little bit about this on YouTube. There's about a 10-minute film. And the striking thing about it is that the musicians, you're right, when you encounter them, you see them up on these rooftops, and given how fraught that environment is, there's a sense of whether, are they doing something constructive? Are they doing something dangerous? Is this permissible? It's very interesting how that plays out, and we'll get back to it. But let me bring in Frédéric, because we haven't heard about your work. I'd like to know more about a project that you began some years ago, This Place. So you'd spent your career as a photographer working in Israel, looking closely at communities there. And then you felt the need to bring in other photographers. And that's a remarkable thing to do. And tell us why and what you tried to accomplish with that.
More exactly, I mean, I spent 25 years traveling everywhere on the planet, basically spending 6 months in 45 different countries, so 25 years, trying to question the very notion of diaspora and how a people, the Jews, were able to survive with a portable identity. I completed this project in 2003. I took some time. And 2006, I had an intuition. What if I were to be able to invite, I didn't know the number, 10, 20, 30, artists, not photo reporters, not journalists, but artists who have developed their own grammar and their own syntax to try to recontextualize Israel as place and metaphor. Israel as the place of the shared origin, a place where three monotheisms, which gave birth to three major narratives, have been in conflict for the last 2,000 years. In other terms, an attempt to look at Israel as a place where the maps of the sacred overlap, compete, and eventually exclude each other. An attempt to get artists, I would say poets, to exit a dual perspective for Israel, against Israel, victim, perpetrators. An attempt to really look beyond the political narrative, not to ignore or bypass it, it's impossible, but to try to really look at the root level, at the archaic stakes, before it becomes political or religious. And when I say first Israel, to recontextualize Israel as place and metaphor, the first metaphor has to do with Israel as a place of radical alterity, of radical otherness, a place where every single person is the other of somebody else, close and far others. Among Jews, you know, an Ethiopian for a Russian, a Moroccan for a German, a French for an American, an Arab Christian for an Arab Muslim, an Armenian for a Jew, and Israel as a place of radical dissonance. And so because I look at Israel as a place of radical otherness, I saw that it was much more appropriate to bring others to question otherness than to be alone to do this work. And as I was carving the working hypothesis of this project, I decided to invite those artists. And it ended up with 12 artists, and the entire idea was to provide for them the time, not a week or a month. Usually today, the average assignment for the New York Times has become from 3 weeks, 5 days in the last 15 years. So the idea was to provide the time, the means, enough money for them to work, and the tools. And I created ad hoc a kind of informal think tank made of some of the most interesting actors of Israeli scene, from architect to archaeologist, from writers, philosophers, a very large spectrum to enable each of those photographers to travel through the largest possible spectrum of narratives, to ultimately, my idea was to get them totally confused, but on a very high level, to create for them a vacuum out of which they would start defining the vectors of their own project.
And I think you made a fairly self-conscious decision that they were not from Israel. They're all from outside Israel, which opens up some room for criticism. They're outsiders. And what right do outsiders have to come in and attempt to understand a culture? I ask this as a journalist, of course. What right do they have to come in as outsiders and attempt to understand a culture in such a brief amount of time?
I mean, to answer very quickly, it's we didn't want photographers to be embedded in the dialectic of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. We wanted outsiders. And even though at the beginning I tried to bring Palestinian photographers, the idea was to have a counterpoint with two Israeli photographers and two Palestinian photographers. At a very early stage, Palestinian photographers who were, and even Israeli Palestinians, not only Palestinians from the West Bank, said we will not participate in a project which takes place on a land of occupation. And I'm a French citizen, you know, I've traveled a lot to Israel. But so while this happened, we then decided to have a project. Again, it was quite consistent to ask others to question the very notion of otherness.
Nabeel, Frederick spoke of otherness. And it strikes me that in your work, you're dealing with a music that to many of the students is going to be somebody else's music, music of otherness. And that's kind of remarkable. I mean, if you think in the United States where we have an inheritance of classical music, your parents, your grandparents might have known it, it's still a challenge to get a young person interested in that music. But you've taken on double challenge, which is not only to compete with the music of popular culture, but to do it with a music that is in fact not necessarily the shared inheritance of many of the young people. Why do that double lift?
For two reasons. But I will start by saying that, you know, we say that every coin has two sides. And in our community, the lack of resources and lack of opportunities sometimes has a positive side as well. Because when you have an opportunity, you just grab it. And for many of the families and the young people, the fact that we were able to bring education of classical music on such a high level was a great opportunity, because they didn't have the luxury of choosing between this and this and that and so many other things, which other families and other young people have in other major cities. If you're in Berlin, you have so many different opportunities, and then you can consider whether you want this or not. So the lack of other opportunities made what we provided something very attractive. So this was helping to us. Why classical music? First of all, it's one of the most powerful educational tools that develop both emotional and cognitive sides of the young people. But from my experience, to be a good classical musician, and classical music differentiates between two things, being sentimental and being expressive. And to be expressive, you need to be able to balance between your mind and intellect and your emotions. So if you're playing a piece by Mendelssohn and you're getting over-emotional, you will ruin the music. If you're being not emotional enough, people will say you're playing like a machine. And this balance between thinking and feeling is very important for our region and for our people. So in a way, classical music is the best way to bring people together to learn about the other, because these encounters can be very emotional. And if you started by doing something together that needs to balance the emotions with the intellect, it's a wonderful way to start this interaction.
I think it's an interesting question then to ask Merlijn, because your music is very different. It's not necessarily playing from the score by Mendelssohn, but it's creating music in the moment. And one way to understand that is that there's great value in having people come together to do something, a common project. But how would that differ, say, from coming together to play a soccer game? How would a piece that you're playing in Bethlehem differ in that sense?
Yeah. Of course, a soccer game has rules, and that makes, inside the rules, you can feel free to really compete and to really have fun. If I design something, I'm also very aware of the fact that I'm an outsider. I come from the Netherlands and I say, hey there, and I bring my viola, and there is curiosity because this viola bring, it's like a promise. Something might happen. And of course the violin is lovely. The case looks, you can also carry a gun in such a case, you know, but the fact that you open it up and there's a violin already, some kind of openness start. And I want to maximize the openness. And also to explain, because very often if you're coming somewhere, people ask you what you're doing here, what's your purpose, can I help you, why are you here? And I hope then my answer takes longer than a simple answer. It's more, actually my goal is to know what I might do there. So to create more openness, more opportunity, because I can never predict the impact of a piece of music, because I cannot design it in my studio and then just send it out like you publish a book, you know, it's ready, you're done, and then you press send to the publisher and there it goes, you know. My projects are really developing in a close interaction with the people, the participants, and also the audience, the community. So it's a journey that we share. And I have not so much to lose, you know. That's because I come from a place, I don't worry so much about myself. I'm very curious. And it gives me the freedom to also take a risk that what we will do might fail. I take a blame. But let's try something new, try something different, and explore some space. What means space? I mean, it means uncertainty. And that's a fragile thing, you know? And in a place like Israel and Palestine, to be fragile, I mean, it's very rare, very exceptional. That's what I met, a lot of activists, people, citizens, musicians. They all have to really defend what they're doing because they're in a situation with a lot of pressure from different sides, you know? And I mean, their own community gives the largest pressure. And to find, to design ways where actually this pressure is gone and people can be fragile, can be open, and can actually question their own nature or their identity or their the nature of their activity, that's a real opportunity.
You said one thing I wanted to follow up on, and that is that the sheer oddity of being this guy from Holland carrying around a violin case in this place elicits a curiosity and an openness. Is that the same on both sides of the wall?
Well, I did some projects in Israel as well. And of course, it was easy for me to really start making music because, well, there is a big infrastructure. The music, it's big there. A lot of youth play music. And when I came to Palestine, also for me, I was not, I had to find also my way as a musician. I could not just say, this is the score of what I composed. Can you just start playing, you know? All this type of, it was like I had a vehicle, but there was no infrastructure serving that vehicle. So I had actually to design a new vehicle in order to really go into that that land.
Okay. Frederick, as I said in the beginning, I kind of thought of you maybe as the odd man out because you're the photographer. But as we began speaking, you kept on using repeatedly musical terms, polyphony and distance among them. And I'm wondering, how do those function in the way you can you know, consider your work?
I feel, it's a great opportunity and it's great serendipity that I was invited with two musicians, two composers. I was raised in a very musical family. My mother is a pianist and I've been performing instrument for 15 years. And when I was 19, I decided to start singing opera and lead. And I would say my vocabulary, my register of words is totally musical. I mean, polyphony is maybe the first word I would use for the project that I created. And dissonance is the second one, the unbearable dissonance that exists in Israel and in the West Bank. And eventually, I saw myself in this project as a vessel for something which grew far beyond my imagination. And I saw myself as I said it in those terms, as the conductor of a big symphonic orchestra trying to get every single photographer to play their own score and eventually to enable them to play all together. And this has been photography has been a journey of self-exploration, and music is the prime source, the well, where I go and drink all the time. And those terms are key for me. And so what is interesting is my medium is photography, so it's about observation, but I would say it's about listening as much and maybe more about listening. And there's this very very beautiful verse in the Bible where it is said that when the Hebrews were at the Mount Sinai, they saw the voices. And this is the perfect adequation between seeing and listening. And I would say without music, I wouldn't have been able to carry on this project. Without being able to listen, I wouldn't have been able to be the vessel for this project.
You've used another word that I'd like to come back to, and as an American, I'm very terrestrial about ideas and so on, so I always want to ground them in a way, and that's alterité. You said that earlier. What is alterité, and how does it sort of embody itself in the work that you're doing?
I believe that alterity is what I was looking for without knowing that I was looking for that when I undertook this journey in diaspora. I mean, we never undertake anything. We are undertaken. And it's always the thing that we don't know about our own history, which lead us to do what we do. And so otherness is really the key word. But otherness is not, for me, philosophy or metaphysics. Otherness is in each of us. It's in each and all of you here. And I would say otherness, for me, start within. Polyphony and Israel offer the greatest possible stage for listening to this polyphony. But unless we listen to the polyphony within, we will never be able to embrace this polyphony outside. And so otherness, can we come to peace with the foreign, the strange, the stranger, but again within? If not, I don't believe. This is the most difficult thing, to live and to embrace otherness.
And again, I'm going to be really terrestrial and ask, difference within. I mean, I understand that in a kind of narrative way. I have different identities. You're talking about something more radical than that. You're talking about a sort of internal rivenness, right? A dividedness in our nature that yes. you're after.
Yes.
Why is that important? Why is that important in the context of thinking about this country, this region, and the larger notion of whether or not people can live together in this kind of space?
Because again, if we do not start, I believe ideology is really a betrayal of the humane in the human. And the reason why I wanted to invite not photojournalists, not reporters, but really artists, poets, I would really speak of a poetic approach to this place. Who are we to shrink to right, left, to those such narrow categories? Yeah. The idea was to expose those artists to the unbearable complexity, let's use again the word dissonance, of this place. And even myself, by inviting photographers from 9 different nationalities, I had to deal with otherness with each of them. And so that's at the core of my project.
Nabeel, your work is bringing together Jewish and Arab kids to make music together. Is the goal there simply that they kind of push their identities aside for the space of time it takes to learn a piece by Mendelssohn? How does otherness operate when they're actually in the same space?
I think the idea behind bringing young Arab and Jewish musicians together to play classical music, work by Mendelssohn or by Schubert, is for a second or for a period of time to say, let's put everything aside and let's create something beautiful together. And I want to relate again to the question, why music? And how is music different than anything else? Because to play a beautiful phrase, when you have a full section of violins playing the same melody, it's not enough to play together in tune or to play together rhythmically, but you have to feel the same way in order for it to sound like one big instrument. And this is what's so special about playing in an orchestra and a symphonic orchestra. And not only that, the oboes, if they're playing the main voice as a first violinist or a second violin, you have to be aware of that and know how to accompany their main voice. So all these things create a very high level of intimacy, which I don't think other fields bring to a joint experience.
Let me ask about that. We could go to a film together, let's say a Steven Spielberg film, and the music swells at the end, and we're all tremendously moved by it, and we could have a collectively intimate experience in the sense that we all had the same emotional reaction to it. You mean something different?
I mean something different, yes. Because it's not just reacting to something from the outside, it's creating something from the inside. And again, to get to the point that everybody in the same section is feeling the same way, it needs a lot of repetition, it needs a lot of commitment and work. So to prepare a symphony by Mozart, you need a large number of hours of rehearsing and repeating. And it takes a lot of commitment for the orchestra to sound as one entity. And that's different from sitting in a theater and listening to something from the outside and reacting to it. But the idea behind doing that is if we bring everybody in the same room and we start talking about the conflict and what is wrong and who's the cause of this situation, it's a sure, for sure, this is a formula for explosion. Because it's very emotional, people get emotional, and then they stop listening. But if we bring them together to create something beautiful, and after rehearsing and playing the concert, they finish this experience and they reflect back on what happened, they say, but we were able to do something beautiful together. We're not that different. I'm not saying at that moment all the differences are gone and everything is beautiful, but that is the beginning of a very long process. That moment is the moment where they let their guard down and they're willing to listen to the narrative of the other and learn more about the other. And this is how our theory of change is very simple. Let them do something beautiful together, and eventually, with time, they will learn more and respect the other more.
And with time, Israelis turn 18 and they have to enlist, and they go to the army 3 years. How does that affect very fragile relationships? Because it's suddenly then you're in different planets again.
It affects because if you've done that, if you are a Jewish Israeli and if you met a young Palestinian musician at the age of 14 and 15, and if you have spent 3 or 4 years together, you have developed an understanding and respect for that person. The Palestinian becomes an individual that you interact with and not something that is foreign and far away. So even if they have to go to the army, they still have that with them. And I can tell you some of the young Jewish, or many of the young Jewish musicians that go to the army are still coming back to be part of this orchestra as well, because they feel it's very important and that message is much needed at this point.
Merlijn, let me ask about sort of the after of your event. So Nabeel has described, they come together and there is a kind of friendship or respect that's established. When you're dealing with events that kind of come together for a short period of time and then everybody goes home, how do you conserve whatever happened in the moment of that time in a constructive way?
It's not just a dilemma of creating music, the fact that you create something and it flies away the moment you stop it. It's also a tragedy. And it brings musicians, of course, creating again and again on different places their music. So what happens with just music happens also with my projects. They're there, they grow, it's like flowers, and then also they go away again. So it's really part of a natural thing. But I myself, I have a lot of trouble accepting that. I feel as an artist, you're encouraged to be original, to be special, or to do something new every time. But that makes it very isolated. Some way I feel it's very tragic for artists that they have to be inventive all the time, because it cannot really grow, because others don't repeat, or it's not like if you start a small company, it becomes a success, everyone starts using your product. It's like a virus. It's like a natural way of growing. But with artists, you have also, people don't want to touch your ideas. No, it's your idea. You should do it. And I wish I could plan the virus. I wish I could do things that others repeat. But it's in some way the law of art that everything should be connected to a person. This kind of being author of something is overestimated, I think. Yeah.
That's a good way for me to introduce a final question I'd like to put to all three of you before we go to questions from the audience. And for this question, I'm going to impersonate an extremely unpleasant member of the audience, not any one of you actually, but just a hypothetical person who would ask a rude question. And that is that, you know, we're talking at a place that diplomats and politicians and people with, you know, important degrees from major universities have spent generations trying to figure out in political terms. Isn't there a naivete about the work you do? You come in as outsiders, you work in art, you are working with things that are ephemeral. How do you respond to the charge that, in a sense, you're doing yoga while the big boys are out there hunting, and you know, you're not actually engaging with the real matter, the political matter, the practical matters that are in this place. And I'd love to hear from all three of you. You're looking at me with a very dark, baleful glance, so I'm going to start with you.
I would like to use a word that Nabeel used, intimacy. I would say that at the core of my preoccupation is intimacy. The last book I published is called An Archaeology of Fear and Desire, and maybe intimacy being the place where fear and desire intersect and the right balance. But I would say from the very beginning of my project, the question at the very beginning was, there's a promise attached to this land. And the question is, what have we done with this promise? What can we do with this promise? And what will this promise do with us? And that has been really at the very beginning of my questioning. And what I believe we have to do, and I come back to otherness, and I will just use another. When I started the project, I encountered a quote of Michel de Montaigne, who said, "We are made of fragments, of such diverse texture, where every single fragment plays its part in such a way that there's more difference between us and ourselves than us and anybody else." And 300 years later, Fernando Pessoa, another Portuguese writer, say, "Each of us is various, many, an overflow of self." And he say, "In the outstretched colony of our being, all kind of people think and feel in various ways." And when I was about to find a title for the project, I thought maybe I will use "The Land I Will Give You to See." And "The Land I Will Give You to See" is in fact not "The Land I Will Give You to Possess," but "The Land That I Will Give You to See" is for me about opening an inner space to stretch our field of consciousness and to be able to embrace, and again, to be able to embrace the other. And yes, we have to do that together, but we cannot make the economy of this introspection and this inner work.
Can I?
Yeah, well, I would say for me, it's an existential struggle. It's not something that I go somewhere and I come back and I have the luxury of saying, well, I did my work and I'm going back home. To your question whether we are naive or not, I would say we're not, because I can see the impact we're having on the community and the young people that are involved. So the answer is no. We understand that the diplomats and the politicians have failed so far, and I feel this on the ground, especially given the last elections and the last year or so. I'm seeing how people are more committed than ever. And one of the troubles of our part, and I think this is something general, that the moderate people, the more open-minded, are the quiet ones and they're heard less. And the more radical, the more extreme, are the ones that are louder. And what I feel is that polyphony is giving those people a way to do something about it, and they feel that through polyphony and through what we do, they are being heard. So I think we're making a progress one child at a time, and that's what we can do.
I love the notion of intimacy. Imagine if I disclose, you cannot hit me, you know? You need a distance if you want to hit someone. If you take more distance, you can fire a gun. If you even take more distance, you can send a missile. The more distance, the more violence you can create. If you're close, it's just impossible to hurt someone. And what's actually more violent, and what's more distance than a missile? Who knows it? That's the power of money. There is no intimacy of money. I can just do some transaction and money, and it goes beyond my view, beyond a feeling of responsibility. And that has big, violent impact. That's also why I learned about the whole conflict, that there is not actually a big problem between the people. I mean, the people I met, I was actually optimistic all the time. I met Israelis, Palestinians. I said, they can live together. There is nothing wrong. And then someone explained to me, look, it's not a problem between people, but it's a matter of real estate and big financial gains from the whole settlement project. Then I learned that is actually the biggest form of violence. And it's very detached. It's just speculation. It's just something, it gives a good revenue. People are ignorant, maybe. They have a big distance to it. And they create a big destruction there.
But if I may, I think to some extent this is not 100% accurate, because there is a lot of misconception and misunderstanding of the other. I agree there's a large number of people in Israel that would relate to some of the Palestinians and their narrative. And if we brought certain number of Palestinians and Israelis together, they would find the way to live together. But there are enough people on both sides that wouldn't be able to find a way to live together. And I think our responsibility is to change the way they think, is to break the stereotypes, and to educate them more about the other narrative and the other, so that they are more tolerant and more understanding of the differences.
Yeah. The intimacy, yeah.
And this is what we did. I mean, by bringing 12 different artists from 9 different nationalities, artists who really make images to break images, they were able to start not understanding this place. The entire idea, the goal is really, will we dare not to understand this place? Will we dare not to connect the dots which make the fabric of this place? And for each of the photographer, it was a transformative experience. You know, we had two photographers who were very, you know, who were involved with the boycott and that, and dared to come there. And what, I mean, I would say my one goal was, will people dare to open their heart? And they did open their heart. Then they opened their mind. But the only thing we understand is really with our body and our sensations, which is why music is the ultimate art.
I remember the first time, if I may just, the first time we invited young Jewish musicians to come to Nazareth to stay for 3 days to rehearse and perform with us. They didn't even get outside of the hotel they were staying at. They didn't feel it's something that they are comfortable and it's an inviting environment. And that was in January 2012. And we had about 8 Jewish musicians and 12 Arab musicians. 2 years after, now when we do this orchestra that brings both Arab and Jewish from all over the country, we have over 55 musicians. And the other time we had that, I was walking at 11 o'clock at night in the streets going to visit the students, and I found them walking in the streets looking for Arabic sweets shop because they felt they wanted to try it. So,
Knafe,
yes, of course. And this
best
is
Knafe in Nazareth.
So this is an example of how much they feel comfortable being in Nazareth and how much they are more comfortable and trusting of the Arab community in Nazareth. So I really believe there's a lot of explaining, there's a lot of educating, and the need to create a positive experiences together to have the largest trust and appreciation of the other.
But you speak of,
we have 5 minutes, and we should let the audience ask a question, but go on while we...
You speak of prejudice, but it starts with ignorance, and it's about fear, ultimately.
Yeah.
So Ray behind you, we'll start there.
Hi, my name's Tyler Green. I'm an art historian, and I run a very small media company. Each of you does something that requires your supporters, your funders, and to some degree, your participants to embrace either risk or uncertainty. One of the things I hear most from art museum directors here in the States is some of the things they would like to do that are more innovative, outside the box, that involve an element of risk or uncertainty, are difficult because boards and funders are afraid of that and prefer certainty. How did you, especially at the outset of your projects, get your funders and backers to embrace risk and uncertainty?
I was very lucky. I mean, I had always big dreams, and if it was not for America, I wouldn't be able to dream my dream in this big way. There are several people, one person, Laurie, who is just sitting here, and who from the very beginning stood at my side, and many people that had funded my previous project, Diaspora, didn't dare to fund the project, say, you know, you're now involving 12 other photographers, how can you guarantee that this will not eventually hurt Israel? But I found very courageous people who dare to stand at my side, and they were a big risk, because whenever you hear Israel and the West Bank, you hear propaganda, and people were afraid to be instrumentalized in a very big way. But I will let each of you.
Yeah. I think it's a similar answer. They're finding the right people. I was very lucky to meet Craig and Deborah Kogut back in 2011. And they loved the idea that Jewish teachers are coming to Nazareth to teach young Arab kids. And then we started discussing together how can we have a larger impact on the Israeli society and not just the Arab society within Israel. And from the other side, there's another side to your question. It's not just the supporters having the confidence to do that, but also for the Arab community to accept support coming from Jewish families. And it made a big change. And it's wonderful to see this two-sided relationship, the Arab community being more willing to accept this support and help, and also encouraging more locals to also take part of this financial burden, but also to see how more and more Jewish families understand that by helping the Arab community in Israel, they're helping the Israeli society as a whole and not just a fraction of it.
So there's one question here.
Nabeel, this is a question really for you. You must be in violation of the BDS, correct? The
yes.
Boycott, yeah.
I guess
and so.
So
I'm curious how you handle that and accusations that by taking funding from Jewish donors that you're normalizing the conditions of power.
My answer is I don't deal with it. We're living in Israel. This is our challenge. From one side, we're Israeli citizens. I am an Israeli citizen. I want to be proud being an Israeli, and I want to be a contributing member of this society. But at the same time, I'm a Palestinian. I was born a Palestinian. I have my natural sympathy to the Palestinian struggle. And I try very much not to compromise any of them. And the boycott people have to understand that as well. I want to bring Arab and Jewish people within Israel. I'm not telling them how to manage their struggle, but they shouldn't tell me how to manage mine as well. And I'm not compromising my commitment to either side. Hopefully one day will come that it will be as simple as an Italian person living in New York being a Palestinian living in Israel. Yeah. That's my dream.
We have time for maybe one more question. So right here.
I wonder if your musicians travel outside of Israel and Palestine, because about 2-3 years ago, our temple had an Israeli-Palestine chamber music group come and perform for us.
That was probably us.
Pardon?
That was probably us.
It was.
Yeah. I can tell you about the experience of the first time bringing Arab kids to perform in a temple. That for me, that was very interesting, because I visited those temples before we came to perform, and for me, it was a striking experience to see that the temple is a place of culture and tradition. And it is less about tradition, about religion and politics in that sense. And it's a very different from understanding what the temple is in Israel, because in Israel, I think also the Jewish people as well would associate a temple with religion and politics. And the parents, for the first time since we started our work, came to me and said, "What are you doing? You're taking our children to play in temples, and they expected to have, you know, Orthodox people, and you know, they expected something that they had in their minds." And for me, it was interesting to see how the young people, after they performed and how welcome they were, going back to their families and telling about that experience. So that was a very interesting. We have done that several times.
I just happened to go to bed and to wake up with poetry. And this morning, I opened one of my favorite book, and I think this is an answer to, you know, we spoke of intimacy, and the last three lines of this poem, which says, only love, only the holder, the flag fits into, and wind, no flag.
And the poet.
And that's Rumi.
We're out of time. I would normally put a bow on it and try and wrap up and say stuff, but forget it. Thank you all. Good.